No.
We are in Colossians chapter 1, beginning in verse 15 today. And again, Paul wrote the book of Colossians, and it's really a blessing to us. Just a proof that God works all things together for good, because there were several heresies in the Colossian church having to do with denigrating Jesus. And so he wrote the book of Colossians, which corrects all those things. So what we have is four chapters that are just jam-packed with teaching about Jesus Christ. Main theme, he's all you need. So let's begin in Colossians 1, verse 15. Father, we ask that you would sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Of course, the subject is Jesus again, verse 15. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? Firstborn of every creature. And some people get a little bit confused about that. They sometimes think that Jesus was a created being, and he is not. Jesus was not the first person that God ever made. Adam was. And some people say, well, Adam existed before Jesus then. No, the Son of God has always existed. As God, he has always existed without a body up until 2,000 and some years ago. But he was there long before God created Adam. In fact, he is the one who created Adam and everything else, as we're going to see. But the Son of God was there long before anything else was created. But Jesus is called the firstborn, so I better tell you what that means. Firstborn, in the biblical sense, has nothing to do with chronology. It has everything to do with position, rank. And so firstborn means the preeminent one, means the one who is in charge, means the one who provides, means the one who instructs. And you think about that, Jesus fits the title of firstborn precisely, because he does all those things. Verse 16, for by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. The thrones, the principalities, the dominions, the powers all refer to different ranks of angels. And so it doesn't matter what it is, whether it's seen or unseen, whether it's in heaven or on earth, whether it's in the spiritual realm or the physical realm, can be in outer space, can be the oceans, can be the galaxies and the entire universe. Everything was made by Jesus and everything was made for Jesus. And I remember, this was a couple of years ago, remember when we were having our Wednesday night Bible study, and a lady who was coming all the time to Wednesday and to Sunday, when I stood up and said that Jesus is God and Jesus is the one who created, she created everything, she got so indignant, she walked out, she never came back. She wrote me a scathing letter for saying that Jesus was the creator. I remember giving her all these verses in Colossians, and it just zoomed right over her head. It didn't matter. She was going to believe what she was going to believe, and that was it. So anyway, let's read verse 16 again. For by him were all things created, things that are in heaven and things that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. Everything was created by Jesus. And don't underestimate the importance of the fact that he created everything for himself. For himself. this is going to be a real eye-opener for a lot of people, even a lot of Christians. It is true that God blesses man. It is true that God has given us all good things to enjoy. But it is not true, as I think some people think, that God made all of creation to be a playground for mankind. He hasn't done that, and neither has He created all things to work together for man's pleasure. Jesus Christ created everything for His good pleasure. That's what the Bible says here. The world does not revolve around us or our feelings or our desires. It revolves around the Lord Jesus Christ and His feelings and His desires. And I said that to say this: don't primarily seek your own good, because that's not why we are here. We are here to please the Lord Jesus Christ. And that should be our goal, because that is the goal of all creation. And I'm sorry if that means that you're not going to be happy all the time. But it doesn't really matter. That's not the issue, as long as Jesus is happy. And I'm sorry that you're not going to get every prayer that you pray answered the way you would like it, no matter how much faith you might have, because that's not the reason for God being, and that's not the reason for prayer. And I'm sorry you're going to be disappointed sometimes. And I'm sorry that sometimes you're going to have to go without certain things. And I'm sorry that the weather isn't always the way you want it to be. But just remember, Jesus never said that this world was made to serve us. And people get disappointed when things don't go their way, or when the weather is lousy, or whatever. They get so disappointed, they get so upset. Sometimes they get angry at God, and I'm thinking, when in the world did He ever promise you that this everything was made to make you happy? Just not the way it is. This world was not made to serve us. This world was made to serve Jesus. And as long as He is getting what He wants, we need to be content with that. Remember, Jesus did not teach us to pray, "My will be done on earth." He taught us to pray, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Verse 17, "And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist." And obviously Jesus had to be before everything, because as we've already seen, He has created everything. So He was before everything. This is one of these deals where I think back, you know, my mind, and it just comes to a blank. Because if you let your mind go back to a point where there was nothing, you have God, and that was it. There was a time when there was nothing but God. And somebody will probably say, because I've heard somebody say this to me a while back, "God must have really been lonely." Somebody said that to me one time. You know, God created man because He was so lonely and He wanted somebody to love. Who in the world comes up with that kind of trash? Somebody who doesn't read the Word of God, I'll guarantee you that. He was not lonely, believe me. He didn't lack anything. And you know why? It's because He is perfect. He is perfect, and because He's so perfect in every way, He was perfectly satisfied with Himself, perfectly content with Himself. He made everything, the Bible says, for His good pleasure, not because He needed anything. He made everything because He wanted to, not because He was lacking something. So, Jesus made everything. That's what the Bible says right here. He made everything, but it also says by Jesus everything consists. That means he keeps everything going. He not only made everything, but he also sustains everything. You say, well, how does he sustain everything? He sustains everything by holding everything together. I love physics. I really love physics. It's just a dirty, rotten shame that I don't have the brains to understand it, because I don't. I try. Sometimes I spend too much time reading and studying physics, trying to grasp something. And once in a while I grasp a little bit, but man, I'll tell you, I don't know much. But I only know what I have read. And I have read that it is completely unnatural for the atoms that make up everything in the entire creation to stay together. It just doesn't make sense. By rights, they should explode away from each other, like when you put two magnets together that both have a positive charge. That's the way it should work with the atoms. So something is holding the atoms together. And therefore, get this, something or someone is holding your body together, is holding this whole planet together, everything on it, the whole universe, everything, someone, something is holding it together and keeping it all, including you, from exploding into non-existence. And it's also my understanding that scientists can't figure out what's doing that. But they do know that there's anywhere between 10 and 50 pounds of pressure holding each and every atom together. And they can't figure out what it is, and they will never figure out what it is, because the answer is not scientific. The answer is spiritual. God tells us right here in the Bible, Jesus is the one who's holding everything together. So if he ever released his grip on atoms, everything, including you and I, would explode. Just completely explode into non-existence. So, if you ever need another reason to put Jesus first in your life and to give him the honor and the respect that he deserves, I think I probably just gave you a pretty good one. He keeps you from exploding. Verse 18. And he is the head of the body, the church. Stop right there. Body isn't much good without a head. You can have strong, skillful hands. You can have legs that run fast. You can have a strong heart. You know, you can have eyes that have 20/20 vision. You can have a voice box that sings beautifully. All these wonderful things. But if the parts of your body are cut off from your head because of a stroke, they're just going to hang limp. They're going to be completely useless. They're not going to work. And it's the same thing with Jesus and us. Without Jesus, who is the head of the church, without Jesus, who is the head of the universal church, which is made up of all Christians, we all hang limp and we become completely and totally useless to Almighty God, which is why we have to stay connected to Jesus. Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. Some people have a hard time believing that because they look at their skills. But without Jesus, Jesus said, apart from me, you could do nothing. It's just like you've known people who've had a stroke, their arm hangs there. You know, they can't talk or something like that. They'd be cut off from the head. And that's what happens when a Christian sins. As soon as you sin, you've been cut off from the head. Your fellowship with Jesus is immediately cut off, and you become useless to the Lord Jesus Christ as far as bearing fruit that glorifies him is concerned. That's why it's so important to avoid sin. But if you do sin, confess it immediately, because that'll immediately restore that connection to the head. Again, verse 18. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. Firstborn from the dead. Okay, firstborn from the dead. That doesn't mean that Jesus was the first person to ever be raised from the dead. There are, I think, 7 people in the Bible who were raised from the dead. But Jesus is the first person to ever be raised from the dead in a glorified body that's never going to die again. So when you look at Jesus being the firstborn from among the dead, that's talking about the fact that he is our prototype, which means that when you look at Jesus and the things that he was able to do after he was raised from the dead, you get a good idea of what you're going to be able to do when your body is raised from the dead too. Eat, drink, walk, talk, touch, be touched. Enjoy your friends, enjoy your family. Anything else that you learn, teach, whatever the case may be, enjoy your friends, enjoy your family. These are all things that Jesus did when he was here after he was raised from the dead. And these are all things that we're going to be able to do as well. Verse 19. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. Zero in on that word fullness just for a second. I'm going to be coming back to that in a couple of seconds here. But it says it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. That means that every speck of God, the entire infinite God, was crammed into the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. The full God was in Jesus when he was here on earth for 33 years in that body. And it's still, the full God is still in Jesus in his glorified body in heaven. And I mentioned the heresies in the Colossian church. And one of the heresies in that church was that there were many, many gods, lesser gods, that emanated from Almighty God who was in heaven. And all these lesser gods were stepping stones. It was taught that they were stepping stones that people had to climb through good works, through sacrificial works, through legalism. That's how you climbed all these lesser gods and all these stepping stones and eventually made your way into the presence of Almighty God. And the heretics there were saying that Jesus was just one of those lesser gods. He may have been in the upper tier, but he was still just one of those lesser gods, one of those stepping stones. And here's the thing that I think is so cool. One of the things that these heretics, well, what the heretics called all these lesser gods as a group was the fullness. So when you take all of these lesser gods, according to this heresy, you take all of these lesser gods, all of these stepping stones to Almighty God, you put them all together, according to the heretics, they're called the fullness. That's the fullness. So what does Paul say? Jesus is the fullness. He's the fullness. That means there's one step to God, and it's Jesus, and that's all there is. One mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Verse 20. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things to himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. So, all things that will be reconciled to God, all people that will be reconciled to God, will be reconciled to God through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're not going to be reconciled to God at all. And I hope that there are some followers of Hare Krishna listening. And I hope that there are some Muslims listening. And I hope that there are some Jewish people listening. And I hope that there are some New Age people listening. Because I just want to tell them right now that no one who dies for Allah will be reconciled to God. But instead, they will go straight to hell. No one who chants Hare Krishna day and night is going to be reconciled to God. But instead, they're going to die and go to hell. No Jewish person who is rejecting the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead 3 days after he was crucified, is going to be reconciled to God by their good works. And speaking of good works, excuse me, and sacrificial works, no one is going to be reconciled to God by any means other than repenting of your sin, asking Jesus Christ to come into your life, be the Lord of your life, and making a commitment to follow him. That's the only way that you're going to be reconciled to God. And you say, well, why do I need to be reconciled to God anyway? Well, look at verse 21. And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now has he reconciled. You realize, most people don't realize this, but every single person who has not repented of their sins and made a commitment to follow the Lord Jesus Christ is an enemy of Almighty God right now. And somebody says, well, I'm not an enemy of God. I know I'm not an enemy of God. I haven't repented. I have not received Jesus Christ into my life and asked him to be my Lord and Savior. I haven't done that, but I know I'm not an enemy of God. You're not an enemy of the God that you have created in your own mind. That's the God that you're not an enemy of. It's too bad that he doesn't exist. But you say you're not an enemy of God. Let's look at this from God's perspective a little bit. And then tell me you're not an enemy of God. I would like to ask somebody who says that these questions. What would you call someone who constantly did things and said things that they knew made you angry? They just kept doing it. You told them to stop, but they did not stop. You told them that you did not like it. You told them that it was offensive to you, but they said, it doesn't matter. I'm going to keep doing what I want to do. I just really don't care what you want. What would you say about somebody like that? You would say that they don't like you. You might say that they were your enemies. Well, now carry that over to God. And just forget about this God that you've created in your own mind, because that doesn't count. Think about the real God. Sin angers him. Sin grieves him. Sin irritates him. And he tells people to quit. If they choose not to quit, then they prove by their actions that they are an enemy of God. Verse 21 and 22. And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now as he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. So God the Father and God the Son are both in on this thing. I never appreciated what God the Father went through on the cross until I became Aaron's dad. Then all of a sudden I realized, man, this was not easy. I always used to think when I was real little, Jesus got the kind of the short end of the stick here, you know? But he died for his enemies. Jesus died for his enemies, which includes all of us. And as I said, our sins are offensive to God. Our sins are a concrete way of us saying, God, I don't care what you want. I'm just going to do what I want. And you do realize that God could have squashed us like a bug long ago. And he would have been perfectly just in doing it. He could have killed us. And he could have sent our souls to hell forever, long ago. And no one could say anything bad about him for doing it either. He would have been perfectly just. But instead of doing that, instead of treating us like the enemies that we were, instead he sent his son, and Jesus, the son, volunteered to come to earth, become a man, die a horrible death on the cross, receive the punishment, and satisfy the justice of God on behalf of us, God's enemies. And you know what's really amazing? Jesus did it, which was horrible. The Father watched it, which had to be just as horrible. I can't imagine watching Aaron die a horrible death in order to save the life of other people. I can't imagine that just by itself. But what would be even worse would be if he died and those that he died to save would spit on his dead body and call him a loser and a fool and dishonor him rather than appreciate his sacrifice. And in essence, that's how most people treat Jesus. You wonder why Almighty God's going to be angry on Judgment Day? You wonder why he's going to send people to hell who not only sinned against him, but rejected the sacrifice of his own son and belittled it and despised it, counted it as an unimportant thing? That's what Jesus did. He died for people, and many of them treat him like he's a loser, and they belittle him, and they dishonor him, rather than appreciate the sacrifice that he laid out by offering himself and accepting him as their Lord and Savior and making a commitment to live for him. And you know what's really amazing to me? Jesus still went through with this thing, and he knew that most people would reject him. But he still did it for the sake of those who wouldn't reject him. 22. In the body of his flesh, talking about being reconciled, how in the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which you have heard, and which was preached to every creature, which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. Now, I know that many people who watch me believe in unconditional eternal security, but I'm asking you for a couple of minutes to set aside what you have been taught in your theology class or in church or whatever. Just please set it aside for a few minutes and just look at what the Bible says, because we all have to look at what the Bible says and measure what we believe and what we teach by that. So you might be one who says, I believe that once a Christian is saved, they will always be saved and they can never lose their salvation. You may be one who says, I believe in unconditional eternal security. I believe in conditional eternal security. I do. But some people believe in unconditional eternal security. And I would ask them this simple question, well, then why in the world did God lay down a condition here? Why did he do that? Why did God say here that you will be saved if you continue in the faith? You say, well, these people were never saved in the first place. I hear that a lot. Well, they were never saved in the first place. That's why they didn't continue. But that's not what the Bible teaches. Look at this. These people were in the faith. God says to them, if you continue in the faith. They were in the faith. He didn't say, if you start in the faith and you continue in the faith. No, they were in the faith, period. But they will only be saved in the ultimate sense of the word if they continue in the faith until they die. Jesus, how many times did Jesus say, he who endures to the end shall be saved? So, the condition is, if you continue in the faith, then you will be saved, which means that it's possible to not continue in the faith, because he also says, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which means that it's possible to be moved away from the hope of the gospel. If those things were not possible, why in the world would God waste his time warning us about it? Somebody says, well, that's a problem verse. No, it's not. It's not a problem. I heard that for years. I heard that. This is a problem verse. It's not a problem verse. You got a problem theology. If it's so crystal clear like this, and you try to twist it and force it into your little theological mold. It's not a problem verse. There's no such thing as a problem verse. This is not a problem verse. It doesn't even have to be interpreted. It just has to be read. It's so crystal clear. Keep in mind that the book of Colossians is written to Christians. Like every other New Testament epistle, it was written to Christians, not to the unsaved. So what is this teaching? It's teaching that a Christian at some point can say, Jesus, I don't want you in my life. And I'm not going to trust you as my Lord and Savior anymore. They can do that. Why? Because our will belongs to us. We don't lose our free will when we become a Christian. And I get the analogy that is used, and I've heard it 1,000 times for the last 35 years. Well, you know, if I have a son or a daughter and they commit a sin, they mess up fellowship with me, but they're still a member of my family, and they're still my son, and they're still my daughter. And that's a wonderful analogy. It's just too bad that it doesn't flow. It's a great story, and it's true enough. I mean, it's true enough. They don't quit being your son or your daughter. That's a fact. I agree with that 100%. But don't get your theology from analogy. Get your theology from the pure Word of God.
I'm not sure what you said.
Because a nice sounding story, or a nice sounding analogy told to make something unbiblical appear to be true still fails to make it true. A lot of people are going to be shocked on Judgment Day because they still had an intellectual belief in the facts about Jesus Christ. But Jesus himself said, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, we did all these things. Why are we being sent to hell? Depart from me, you workers of iniquity, he will say. Some people are going to be shocked. Many are going to be shocked. Because they thought that since they were baptized or confirmed or prayed the sinner's prayer, they were saved, man. Even though they stopped believing in Christ, even though they stopped reading the Bible, even though they stopped trusting in Jesus, they thought they were okay because they were told, once you have it, man, you can't lose it. They lost it. 24. Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you. Stop there for a second. You got to love the Apostle Paul. Because what he's saying here is, I don't care how much it costs me. I don't care how much pain I have to feel. I don't care how much sacrifice I have to make. If I can say something or I can do something that helps your walk with Jesus, then that by itself more than makes up for any pain that it might cost me to help you along in that way. That's an attitude. Man, that is a great attitude. That's the only attitude that's acceptable. If we don't have that attitude, we call ourselves a Christian, and we don't have that attitude, then we don't love Jesus Christ like we should. There's something lacking. If you're not willing to pay any price and bear any burden and endure any hardship in order to make the Lord Jesus Christ happy, then you're not filled with the Spirit of God. No Christian should ever settle for anything less than being completely filled, permeated with the Holy Spirit in control of every area of their life. And if they're not, at that particular second, they're not filled with the Holy Spirit at that second, I don't care what anybody says, they're just not. And I can say this too. And this is just from the human point of view. You'll never have the peace that you are searching for. And you will never have the joy that you know is lacking in your life. And you will certainly never be as fruitful as Jesus wants you to be as long as you are holding back any area of your life from God. If Jesus is off limits to any area of your life, you're reserving that to you, then your attitude isn't what it should be. And you're not filled with the Spirit of God. And no wonder you're lacking peace and joy. 24. Who now rejoice in my sufferings for you, and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church. When Jesus suffered on the cross and died paying for our sins, the last thing that he said was, it is finished. Which means that he suffered everything that needed to be suffered in order to pay the penalty for our sins. So he doesn't lack anything in that suffering. And you can't add anything at all through personal suffering to help get your sins forgiven or help earn your salvation in any way. The cross of the Lord Jesus Christ accomplished everything that we need for forgiveness and eternal life and to escape hell. The sufferings of the death of Christ are complete. But the sufferings of the life of Christ are not complete. And that's what Paul is talking about here. They are completed in and through the lives of faithful Christians. And only through the lives of faithful Christians. And this is our calling. Goes back to what I said at the very beginning about the world not revolving around us, but revolving around Jesus. This is our calling. This is the will of God, that we live for Jesus, that we live the Word of God, that we speak the Word of God, and not compromise our holiness in order to please the crowd or to please the people at work or to please the people at school, whatever the case, not to please anyone. This is the will of God, that we live like Jesus lived and like Paul lived and suffer during our lives like Jesus did and like Paul did. Jesus was despised and he was rejected by man, the Bible says. He was a man of sorrows. He was acquainted with grief. And so, if to some degree you and I are not despised and rejected, if we are not men and women of sorrow and acquainted with grief, if we are not acquainted with grief at the hands of the unsaved who despise the Word of God, who despise Jesus Christ, who abhor biblical principles and truths, if we are not despised and acquainted with grief at their hands and also at the hands of lukewarm Christians, then we're not living for Jesus the way we should be, because Jesus himself said, all who live a godly life in Christ Jesus, the Bible says, will suffer some form of persecution. That's exactly what we're talking about here. It's just another verse that teaches the exact same thing. You can't run from it. It's truth. It's a fact. If you're not suffering in some way and sharing in the sufferings of Christ, you are not living the way Jesus wants you to live. Christ expects us to fill up that which is behind in his afflictions. And you don't have to go looking for trouble. You just live for Jesus and speak the truth. It'll come find you. And then you'll be doing what Jesus did. 25.
I'm not sure.
Whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. Anyone who thinks, I'm going to stop with this. But anyone who thinks, let me read this again. Wherefore I am made a minister. And that means servant, of course. I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. Anyone who thinks that being a minister of the word of God of Jesus Christ is a career or a job or a profession should get out of the ministry, because they have the whole thing wrong. Many years ago, when I was just a young Christian, a few years in the Lord, I guess, I was going to a church here in town, and I was actually an elder in this church, and the pastor confided in me. And he was really upset, really, really upset. And he told me why. He said, you know, Mike, I've been out of Bible college and seminary for 5 years now, and I'm just not making the kind of money that I think I should be making. And I didn't say anything to him, but I thought, that just doesn't make sense to me. Doesn't make sense to me, because I had just finished. I had just concluded. I had just concluded going 2 years, 2 years of going to Stevens Point, which is, for those who don't know, it's about 70 miles both ways. I just concluded, as he was saying that to me, going to Stevens Point for 2 years every week on Saturday night, conducting a worship service. And I always, in addition to driving the 70-some miles, I always got to Stevens Point early. And I went to different places and I witnessed to people before I went to the service. And then I'd go to the service, and it was a three-hour service. And I always taught verse by verse for an hour. For 2 solid years, I never missed a week. I never got one single cent for any of that, not one penny. And I never asked for them. And I'm not saying that there weren't probably times, I don't remember, there were probably times when I thought, you know, I probably should get something because the Bible does say that the laborer is worthy of their pay. Nevertheless, I still counted it an honor and a privilege to serve the Lord Jesus Christ and to feed his people the word of God. So when he said that, man, that doesn't even make sense to me. I don't understand that at all, and I'm glad that I didn't understand it, and I still don't. God says here in verse 25 that to be a minister is to be commissioned by Almighty God. So if I'm talking to somebody right now and you're thinking that way, and I know there are some denominations, man, that's just the way it is. I mean, they try to get all these baptisms, you know, get people saved, so-called, get them to repeat the sinner's prayer as quickly as they possibly can because it looks good on the ledger, and then they can move up to a bigger church and maybe in the denomination, a bigger, more important spot that pays more money, you know, whatever. Whatever that garbage is. What a bunch of trash. What a bunch of unbiblical, ungodly, worldly trash. Verse 25 says that to be a minister means to be commissioned by Almighty God. And if you're commissioned by God, and you're called by God to teach the word, you're happy to preach, and you're happy to teach the word of God, whether you get paid for it or not. If you're commissioned by God, that is a calling. That is not a career. And you can't stand it if you're not teaching the Bible. And if you have never repented of your sin, to those of you who are watching this at home, if you've never repented of your sin and asked Jesus Christ to come into your life to be your Lord and Savior, here's your opportunity, and don't put it off. Because as I said earlier, you could be dead 10 seconds from now. You don't have any guarantees. You might be healthy. You know that doesn't matter. We've all known people who died suddenly, unexpectedly. And if you die without Jesus Christ, you're going to go to hell. I didn't make that up. That's what Jesus said. Jesus said, if you don't believe in me, you will die in your sins. And to believe in him means that you have to repent. You have to receive him as your Lord and Savior and make a commitment to follow him. So if you want to do that, you say, how do I do that? I feel like I want to go to hell. Okay. That's good. I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you want to do it, you pray along with me and you mean business. Christ will save you. You won't have to worry about dying and going to hell. So pray with me. Father, I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve hell. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died on the cross to pay for my sin. I repent of my sin. I invite you to come into my life. Lord Jesus, take control of my life. Be the Lord of my life. Save my soul from hell. Wash away all my sins. Help me to live for you. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer and you were serious, you've become a child of God. And now what you need really badly is the Word of God. So keep tuning into this program, but also go to the Scripture Verse by Verse website, because there you can find everything that you need to grow spiritually. You can study the whole Bible like we did today, verse by verse, from Genesis through Revelation, using my audio Bible commentaries, and that can be found at thebibleversebyverse.com. That's thebibleversebyverse.com. And I just want to remind you, all of you who are listening, if you're a Christian, I'm not talking to unbelievers, I'm talking to Christians right now, your prayers and financial support are greatly appreciated, because I'm not underwritten by a large denomination or a large church or anything like that. So your prayers, financial support are greatly appreciated. My address is Scripture Verse by Verse, Post Office Box 2211, Wausau, Wisconsin 54402-2211. Again, Scripture Verse by Verse, Post Office Box 2211, Wausau, Wisconsin 54402-2211. And Father, we thank you for letting us be in your word today together. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Let the beauty of the Lord our God rest upon us and establish the work of our hands for us. In Jesus' name, amen.